Hello everybody, I'm Arnon Nagler from Shiva Tel Shomer, Israel, and my topic today is how does stem cell source impact GvHD? So as we know, GvHD is the main obstacle for successful bone marrow transplantation. Till few years ago, there was no progress, but recently we have a major progress in GvHD, and we have two drugs already approved for acute GvHD and chronic GvHD. And the REACH 3 study was for chronic GvHD, was just presented a few days ago at ASH. Very, very good time for GvHD and for transplant. Now, for many years, we know that peripheral blood cause more GvHD and mainly more chronic GvHD than bone marrow. The reason for it is that in the peripheral blood we have 70% T cells, while in the bone marrow only 7%. Also, the number of cells that are given to patients in transplant are much higher with peripheral blood stem cells transplantation than in bone marrow transplant. And there are some data that bone marrow and especially the stroma cell can also induce tolerance. So overall, many studies and meta-analyses and two-arm studies have shown that there are more GvHD in peripheral blood stem cell. Now, as for conditioning, we have two types of conditioning, the myeloablative and reduced intensity. And although not in all studies, but yes, there is somewhat less GvHD from with reduced intensity conditioning than with myeloablative conditioning. But the use of peripheral blood and the reduced intensity conditioning change the timing and a bit the presentation of GvHD. And so we are not talking for the last, I guess, 10 years or so on acute and chronic that are discriminated by day 100 post-transplant, but we have overlapping GvHD and we have acute and chronic. The new thing for GvHD prevention, or one of the new things, are the post-transplant cyclophosphamide post-transplantation that was developed for haploidentical transplant, but it was very successful in reducing GvHD, reducing transplant-related mortality and improving result, that it moved also for unrelated transplant and even for sibling transplantation. And there are many studies that compared post-transplant cyclophosphamide to, let's say, ATG, or the conventional way of prevention GvHD in haploidentical transplantation, unrelated transplantation, and sibling transplantation. Overall, this data show in general, not in every study, that there is a trend, or maybe less chronic GvHD at least, with haploidentical transplantation than in unrelated transplant, sometimes a bit more or equal acute GvHD in haplo compared to unrelated transplant. Historically and always in unrelated transplantation, there is more GvHD than in sibling transplantation, and especially more chronic GvHD. And this is the main limitation or complication in unrelated transplantation. So with the comparison of post-transplant cyclo to ATG, in some of the works, including works from the acute leukemia working party of the EBMT, the post-transplant cyclo can overcome a mismatch, one locus mismatch in transplant. This is a paper we published last year. So the same GvHD in 9 out of 10 and 10 out of 10 transplant with the post-transplant cyclo. When we compared in a blood paper post-transplant cyclo to ATG in 9 out of 10, so mismatch unrelated, there was advantage for post-transplant cyclophosphamide. And in the comparison in the sibling transplantation, then there is advantage for ATG. So the results were somewhat as for GvHD in sibling transplant in AML was better with ATGs and post-transplant cyclophosphamide. And now we also compared in a recent paper a bone marrow haploidentical transplant with bone marrow compared to peripheral blood with unrelated, both with post-transplant cyclophosphamide, and there was lower incidence of GvHD with haplo bone marrow. Many years ago, we compared bone marrow without ATG to a peripheral blood with ATG in unrelated sibling transplantation. And in that case, there were similar results of the GvHD relapse-free survival in sibling transplant, but advantage for bone marrow without ATG in unrelated transplantation. And recently, we did this comparison in ALL, acute lymphatic leukemia. So in comparing post-transplant cyclophosphamide to ATG in haploidentical transplant, there was advantage for the post-transplant cyclophosphamide. And recently we did the comparison for sibling, and here the incidence of GvHD was similar between between ATG and post-transplant cyclophosphamide for ALL in a patient with ALL. We also, as for graft source, we also have to discuss cord blood transplantation. That is less popular these days, but there is some advantage for cord blood transplant. Like Seattle have shown that in a patient with MRD positivity, ML, cord blood is better than, for instance, unrelated transplantation. It's still used and popular in pediatric patients. Less so at adults, but there are some data with expansion cord blood and very nice result. Anyway, cord blood transplantation and historically has less GvHD than other source of graft, but this is also becoming controversial when we talk on adult transplantation. So this is true in a pediatric transplant. True in most of the studies in adult transplantation, but not all of them. So I would say that as for GvHD, that it's a major complication in transplantation. One, there is a major progress in recent years, and two compounds were already approved and are being developed and very successful. Then it's the type of conditioning, the source of the graft, and the type of the donor dictate or influence the incidence and severity and timing. And also we did not discuss the organ distribution of GvHD, both acute and chronic. And actually there is interplay between the conditioning, the HLA mismatching, and the GvHD prophylaxis. All of these affect, like in a puzzle, the incidence of GvHD post-transplant, but the good news is that we are having now novel drugs and new ways of therapy to conquer this very severe complication after a transplant that causes major morbidity and mortality. Maybe we should also say that usually GvHD goes hand to hand with graft versus leukemia effect, and especially in reduced intensity conditioning, chronic GvHD together with acute or alone reduce substantially the incidence of GVL. So also in all the studies of reducing GvHD, there was also always the worried that the relapse rate will increase, but there are today ways and studies that show that you can reduce GvHD without the cost of increasing relapse rate. So thank you for the invitation.